Good morning, Hampton Academy. Before we start today's Memorial Day Assembly, I'd like you to all please stand in silence as we welcome our esteemed veterans. Please be seated. Okay. I'd like to welcome everyone to our Memorial Day Assembly and thank you for being here with us today. At this time, I'd like to introduce our Masters of Ceremony for the Assembly, Hannah Edgar, Elizabeth Hunter, and Ryan Rosberg.
Thank you, Mr. Hawkins. Today, we gather as a community to observe Memorial Day. The students and teachers of Hampton Academy have prepared presentations to help us better understand the true meaning of this national holiday and to honor the lives of the Americans whose lives were lost in service to their country and its people.
In his speech during the first national commemoration of what was then called Decoration Day on May 30th, 1868, General John A. Logan of the Grand Army of the Republic honored the sacrifices of Civil War soldiers, saying, "We do not know one promise these men made, one pledge they gave, one word they spoke, but we do know they summed up and perfected, by one supreme act, the highest virtues of men and citizens. For love of country, they accepted death and thus resolved all doubts, which made immortal their patriotism and their virtue."
As we prepare to reflect on history of this solemn day and the patriotism and sacrifice of those who gave all in the Civil War, World War I, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, worldwide conflicts between 1975 and 1990, the Gulf War, and the Global War on Terrorism. Let us now stand for the presentation of the colors by Peter Furtado and Ketty LeBlanc, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance by Sydney Heaston. Please remain standing for the national anthem performed by the 7th and 8th grade band.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Thank you, Sydney, and members of the band. At this time, we welcome six Hampton students, Avery Austin, Evan Christie, Dylan Deneve, Chase Hamilton, and Taylor Lafreniere, presenting the origins of Memorial Day and a tribute to the American flag.
Origins of Memorial Day. Formerly called Decoration Day, Memorial Day is a day where we honor the soldiers who have fought for our country but have sadly passed away. It was deemed a national holiday and passed by Congress in 1971 and is always celebrated on the last Monday in May. There are many ways to honor those who have passed, such as attending parades and public ceremonies and putting flags at graves of those who are no longer with us.
A day of honor. People honor Memorial Day in many different ways. Some people visit a former battlefield, others may tune into a Memorial Day concert. You can also attend Memorial Day parades, take part in memorial service, or visit a veteran's home. Another way you can take part in Memorial Day from home is by raising an American flag to honor the veterans, all those who serve our country, and all who died in service to our country.
The American flag. One of the greatest symbols of our pride and love for our country is the American flag. Waving proudly across the country at government buildings, schools, libraries, and homes, the American flag inspires awe and reminds us daily of the sacrifices made by so many to ensure our safety and our freedom.
There have been 27 versions of the American flag. The current version is the only one to have lasted 50 years. The current American flag is not professionally designed. It was designed by a 17-year-old high school student, Robert G. Heft of Lancaster, Ohio, who submitted the design in a contest in 1958. It was chosen out of over 1,500 designs by President Dwight D. Eisenhower. The flag was first officially raised on July 4, 1960.
Why does our flag have 13 stripes? The American flag has 13 stripes to represent the 13 original colonies. The red stripes represent hardiness and valor, and the white stripes represent purity.
Why does our flag have 50 stars? Our flag has 50 stars to represent the 50 states in America. The blue background for the stars represents vigilance, perseverance, and justice.
The history of the American flag. Although the American flag has changed over the course of our country's history, it has always been a symbol of pride and love for our country. The American flag deserves our respect each and every day, as it reminds us of all those who served in the past and who are currently serving to protect, defend, and honor the United States of America.
Requiem by Lenore Hetrick. Let our songs rise sweet and gently for soldiers gone who once were here. Let the music whisper softly for this flowering springtime of the year. Those for whom we offer song on this new Memorial Day once were young and laughing too, yet now they have fallen away. From the towns and from the farms, light of heart the soldiers came. Each one wore upon his brow a tall yet invisible flame. To the sound of forceful horns, the soldiers swiftly marched away. They marched to beating of the drums and knew they had but to obey. So today, let songs be soft and sweet for this flowering springtime of the year. We sing for those who once were young and once were happy and once were here.
Thank you, Six Hampton. With a presentation on Dogs of War, please welcome Seven Hampton students, Emily Arlington, Xavier Lapierre, Kit McManus, Ella O'Brien, Aiden Reynolds, Dominic Sfraza, Eve Sermain, Morgana Silva Crosgrove, and John Valhuli to the stage.
Memorial Day is a special occasion in our country. It is a day of remembrance when we are asked to acknowledge the sacrifice of men and women who have served and died in the line of duty. But for over half a century, there have been others, not humans, that have given themselves to the country they call home. These are hardly just dogs. Throughout our history, in nearly every major battle, soldiers have had a canine companion who has stood by their sides and given their own lives to protect those who protect us. The sacrifice of these fuzzy soldiers has been noted. Though rarely celebrated and honored, today we wish to pay tribute.
March 13, 1942 marked the day when the U.S. Canine Corps began. Military personnel noted that dogs had unique qualities that made them especially useful in times of war. Not only were dogs used to provide much-needed emotional support to soldiers, but they risked their lives as messengers, traveling twice as fast and for longer distances than their human counterparts. When the U.S. canine program began, more than 30 different breeds were accepted as trainees. However, it didn't take long to narrow that list down. Only five breeds demonstrated the qualities for military action. These breeds are the German Shepherd, Doberman Pinscher, Farm Collie, Giant Schnauzer, and Belgian Sheepdog.
The jobs that a military dog can do are numerous. In World War II, dogs were first used as parachuters alongside their human handlers. Parachuting dogs became popular as it allowed for the dogs to be used by soldiers immediately upon entry into war zones. These pictures give new meaning to the phrase, taking your dog out for a walk. Black Ops, or Special Forces dogs, are specially trained to use their incredibly keen sense of smell to do the jobs that humans can't. These dogs have the difficult work of sniffing out explosives, clearing the way for soldiers. They can also find humans in hiding.
In addition to their sense of smell, the dog's sense of hearing is also beyond that of a human. This hearing is what makes the job of a medic dog valuable. Red Cross dogs can hear a wounded soldier in thick brush and can carry medical supplies to rescue military personnel where a human may not. Even when a human soldier has completed their service for the country, dogs continue to dedicate themselves for their lifetime. Therapists and animal experts have recognized the value of canine companionship to our veteran men and women. Service members suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome depend on the emotional stability that a dog can offer.
Given the tremendous importance of these canine warriors, it seems only fitting that their dedication be memorialized through monuments around the world. From Guam to New Jersey, humans have thanked their dog counterparts for their service to their country. Like humans, many have served and returned home, while others have not been so fortunate. Giving their lives to the United States of America is something that these veterans, both human and dog, do as a remarkable and heroic act.
Like our human soldiers, the loss of one of these service members is felt with tremendous gravity. When a dog falls in the line of duty, they are honored in a way similar to that of a wounded warrior. Their food bowl is turned upside down, and their protective gear is hung beside. A poem, Guardians of the Night, is read in their memory.
Guardians of the Night, trust in me, my friend, for I am your comrade. I will protect you with my last breath when all others have left you, and the loneliness of the night closes in. I will be at your side. Together we will conquer all obstacles and search out those who might wish to harm others. All I ask of you is compassion. The caring touch of your hands is it is for you that I will unselfishly give my life and spend my nights unrested. Although our days together may be marked by the passing of the seasons, know that each day at your side is my reward.
My days are measured by the coming and going of your footsteps. I anticipate them at every opening of the door. You are the voice of caring when I am ill, the voice of authority when I've done wrong. Do not chastise me unduly, for I am your right arm, the sword, at your side. I attempt to do only what you bid of me. I seek only to please you and remain in your favor.
I will quietly listen to you and pass no judgment, nor will your spoken words be repeated. I will remain ever silent, ever vigilant, ever loyal. And when our time together is done and you move on in the world, remember me with kind thoughts and tales. For a time, we were unbeatable. Nothing passed among us undetected. If we should meet again on another street, I will gladly take up your fight. I'm a police working dog, and together we are guardians of the night.
Thank you for your time and patriotism as we honor all those who have given their lives for our country's freedoms. Keep the memories of those heroes, human and canine, in your heart this holiday weekend. Remember that each life sacrificed has given you the opportunities you enjoy each day.
Thank you, Seven Hampton. Please welcome to the stage Isla Christie, Megan Nato, and Maeve Willette from 8 Hampton presenting their own original Memorial Day poems.
The guilt of survival.
Isla Christie as soldier.
Megan Nato as sister. 58,220 American casualties.
November 1st, 1955 to April 30th, 1975.
The Vietnam War. They're retreating.
I'm leaving. Why am I still here when they aren't?
Thank God he's still here. Whether we won or lost, it doesn't matter. Thank God he's still here.
My friends, my brothers in arms, gone. All of them, gone.
20 years and my life has remodeled itself to fill the unintentional gap that he has left behind.
It feels wrong that I'm still breathing while their families are grieving. It's not right that I'm leaving. This whole war was so deceiving, and forever I'll carry this empty feeling.
58,220 American casualties. Almost 60,000, and he wasn't one of them. I know his friends were. I hope it doesn't kill him, not after all he's done.
On the ride back to the Americas, the waves pitching the boat side to side, back and forth, I found myself drawn to the railing, watching the waves crash over the sides of the boat. Why am I still here? Why? Why? Air still travels in and out of my lungs while theirs have ceased their constant rise and fall.
War changes a person. I'm unsure if he'll be the same when he returns.
November 1st, 1955 to
April 30th, 1975.
The Vietnam War. The longest war in American history.
Sacrifice. What is sacrifice? Sacrifice is letting your best friend borrow your favorite toy. Sacrifice is leaving your tooth fairy money in the piggy bank to save up for the thing that you really, really want. Sacrifice is giving your lunch money to someone else that needs it more. Sacrifice is giving up your seat for an elderly person on the bus. Sacrifice is volunteering your time for others. Sacrifice is the financial and emotional stability of your guardian. Sacrifice is watching your mother, father, sister, or brother tear up at the sight of watching you leave for the military, not knowing if you will return. Sacrifice is substituting an interaction with your husband or wife for a mere letter. Sacrifice is watching your bunkmate suffer in a hospital tent. Sacrifice is stepping onto the battlefield, waving hello to death. Sacrifice is losing your life for the betterment of your country, a sacrifice so large, not even a million thank yous can match its significance. It's the ultimate sacrifice, something that cannot be repaid, only remembered. We remember the suffering, we remember the pain, we remember the victory. We remember the smiles of those whose lives you saved, whose lives you protect. Thank you for making this day possible. Thank you for the sacrifices that you made, those that cannot ever fully be repaid. Thank you to those brave men and women that have made the ultimate sacrifice.
Thank you, 8 Hampton, for sharing your poetry with us. From 6 Academy, please welcome Aiden Bean, Max Borden, Molly DePippo, Lucy Grody, Allie Hamlin, Bryson LaPan, Renee Mama, Connor McCarthy, Reagan Page, Olivia Robinson, Audrey Rolston, Joseph Roy, Amelia Skaversky, and Zoe Ziegler with their presentation, Remembering Their Names, a reading of the names of family and friends of Hampton Academy who made the ultimate sacrifice.
Good morning. Today, Hampton Academy would like to take the time to remember the sacrifices of these American heroes by saying their names aloud. Saying the names of these men and women keeps their memory alive, the memory of their service, commitment, dedication, and love of country. It reminds their families that we continue to stand with them and that we will never forget them. These names were submitted by you, our fellow students and staff members. These were the people who were important to you and your families, and now they are important at Hampton Academy as well. We will ring a bell to remember each name. Please be respectful of this moment. From the U.S. Navy, Lieutenant William Goodwin. Petty Officer Bob Casey. Petty Officer First Class Seth Johnson.
Lieutenant Commander Eric Christensen. Lieutenant Brendan Duffy. Lieutenant Bruce Donald.
Seaman Carlton Howe. Lieutenant Scott Milley. From the U.S. Army, Thiago Sanazaro.
Jean-Paul Coulet. Airman Alan Sisson. First Lieutenant James Stewart.
Second Lieutenant Margaret Stewart. Christopher Curtis. Joan Casey.
From the U.S. Air Force, Brian Potvin. Russell Draper. Arthur Bunce.
Captain William Pfeiffer.
Lieutenant Michael Ayotte. And from the U.S. Marine Corps, Sergeant Andrew Farrar.
Major Megan McClung. Major Douglas Sembeck. Private First Class Daniel King.
Sergeant First Class Daniel Munro. From the U.S. Coast Guard, Lieutenant Edward Hampstead. Thank you.
Thank you, Sixth Academy. At this time, we'd like to welcome the 7th and 8th grade band under the direction of Miss Jillian Guay for their performance of America the Beautiful.
Thank you to the band for your patriotic performance. We will now present a reading of the John McRae poem, In Flanders Fields, by 7-8 Academy team students Katie Millett and Sophie Monjoiner.
In Flanders Fields. This poem was written during the First World War by Canadian physician Lieutenant Colonel John McCrae. He was inspired to write it on May 3, 1915, after presiding over the funeral of friend and fellow soldier Lieutenant Alexis Helmer, who died in the Second Battle of Ypres.
At that time, he noted how poppies quickly grew around the graves of those who died in the battle. According to legend, fellow soldiers retrieved the poem after McCrae. Initially dissatisfied with his work, they discarded it. In Flanders Fields was first published on December 8th of that year in the London magazine Punch. In Flanders Fields, the poppies blow
between the crosses, row on row,
that mark our place, and in the sky,
the larks still bravely singing fly.
Scarce heard amid the guns below,
we are the dead short days ago.
We lived, felt dawn, saw sunset's glow.
Loved and were loved, and now we lie
in Flanders Fields.
Take up our quarrel with the foe.
To you from failing hands we throw.
The torch be yours to hold it high.
If ye break the faith with us who die,
we shall not sleep though poppies grow in Flanders Fields.
Thank you, 7-8 Academy. At this time, we are honored to introduce American Legion Post 35 Commander Burke Bennett for our keynote address.
Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Hawkins and Mrs. Hughes and the faculty and staff here at Hampton Academy for inviting us. I'd like to thank the students of Hampton Academy for their wonderfully touching and appropriate presentations. I think you all deserve a round of applause. We've also noticed that about half the school's in the band. Fine job. This year marks 50 years since U.S. combat troops pulled out of South Vietnam in 1973, ending America's direct military involvement in that war. The Vietnam War was the most controversial, and until the war in Afghanistan, the longest war in our nation's history. But today I'm not going to discuss the war itself. Many books have been written about the war and how it was conducted, and scholars will be debating it for generations. I want to touch on our veterans who fought the war and remember those who didn't come home. Specifically, I want to talk about the Vietnam vets who are members of American Legion Post 35, your relatives, neighbors, and friends. About half our members are Vietnam-era vets, and many served in Vietnam doing many different jobs. Some members were supply specialists, making sure our soldiers had the food and equipment they needed to fight the war. Some were in the Air Force, loading the bombs onto the B-52s, or aircraft mechanics, and some were pilots flying tankers that refueled our fighters, or flying unarmed cargo planes into remote outposts, sometimes under enemy fire. Some were helicopter pilots, ferrying soldiers into battle and evacuating the wounded. Some of our women members were nurses during the war, providing life-saving medical care to our wounded. Other members were in the Navy, serving aboard landing ships, bringing supplies and vehicles to the Army and Marines along the coast, or they were aboard large amphibious assault ships, which supported the Marines offshore. Some were Marine Corps engineers, operating the heavy equipment that helped build the McNamara Line south of the DMZ. A handful of our members were Army or Marine infantry, known as the grunts. They were the ones who did the majority of the fighting, and many experienced fierce combat. To these soldiers on the ground in Vietnam, they didn't care about the grand strategy of the generals. What mattered out in the boonies was keeping yourself and your buddies in one piece. It was the grunts who jumped out of the helicopters into hot landing zone under enemy fire. It was the grunts slogging through rice paddies with mud so thick it sucked the boots right off their feet. It was the grunts who moved through sharp elephant grass taller than a man, or marched up and down mountains in a helmet and flak vest, all while carrying up to 80 pounds of gear. It was the grunts who were the forward observers at the front lines, calling for artillery support to stop an enemy attack. And it was the artillery battalions at the fire support bases who answered their prayers. Being a grunt meant dealing with the heat, humidity, the torrential rain, insects and snakes, all while being on the lookout for ambushes and booby traps. It meant searching for an enemy that was hard to find and harder to fight. It meant finding a war where we controlled the villages by day, but by night they belonged to the Viet Cong. It meant measuring success on the battlefield by body counts, rather than by taking and holding territory on the ground. More than 50 years later, the war still affects our Vietnam veterans. Many suffer from PTSD, some shot out in their sleep, still fighting a battle that began long ago, but for them, never seems to end. Some suffer from the effects of Agent Orange and are now suffering from cancer, heart disease, and other health problems. Some still have bullet fragments or shrapnel in their body from a firefight or a mortar attack over 50 years ago. They all paid a price for serving in Vietnam, and some would say they left a big portion of their life over there. One of our members, looking for closure, actually went back to Vietnam to help look for the remains of a fellow soldier from his unit who was killed and never recovered. Another served in a unit where a young Marine was awarded the Medal of Honor after he was killed throwing his body on a grenade, saving the lives of his fellow Marines. I can tell you, that veteran thinks of that young Marine every day of his life. A lot of our veterans suffer from survivor's guilt, wondering why they made it and others didn't. Many still think about their experiences in Vietnam daily. We need to remember our Vietnam veterans, and as a nation and as a community, thank them for their service and their sacrifice. Now I want to take a moment to remember our soldiers and Marines from our local area who were killed in Vietnam. You see their names on various street signs and parks in Hampton, honoring their memory. They are First Lieutenant Bruce Brown, United States Army. Specialist Fourth Class Mark Brown, United States Army. Captain John Falcone, United States Army. Private Stephen Philbrick, United States Marine Corps. Major Murray Smith, United States Air Force, all from Hampton. And Private First Class Robert Shaw, United States Marine Corps, from Northampton. Their names are among the 58,276 American servicemen and women killed in the Vietnam War, whose names are etched in the polished black granite panels of the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington. Please take a moment this weekend to think of all those who gave their lives in all wars for our country. They fought and died so we can enjoy the peace and freedom that this nation holds so dear. Thank you.
Thank you, Commander Bennett. It is my pleasure to introduce Chief Master Sergeant Alex Reno, United States Air Force, retired with Peter Furtado, Victor Kohlberg, and Kenny LeBlanc to present the folding of our flag.
No flag ever devised by man has so clearly expressed the ideal of true democracy in its design. It has been literally the guiding star of our pioneers, explorers, humanitarians, and soldiers. It has interwoven in its threads into the texture of every chapter of our national romance. No man, woman, or child can comprehend the majesty of the history of the United States who is ignorant of the story of old glory. A thoughtful mind, when it sees a nation's flag, sees not the flag, but the nation itself, and whatever may be its symbols, its insignia, he reads chiefly in the flag, the government, the principles, the truths, the history that belongs to the nation that sets it forth. The American flag has been a symbol of liberty. Men and women rejoice in it. For more than 200 years, the American flag has been the symbol of our nation's unity, as well as a source of pride and inspiration for millions of citizens. Born on June 14, 1777, the Second Continental Congress determined that the flag of the United States be 13 stripes, alternating between 7 red and 6 white, and that the Union be 13 stars, white in a blue field representing a new constellation. Between 1777 and 1960, the shape and design of the flag evolved into the flag presented before you today. The 13 horizontal stripes represent the original 13 colonies, while the stars represent the 50 states of the Union. The colors of the flag are symbolic as well. Red symbolizes hardiness and valor. White signifies purity and innocence. And blue represents vigilance, perseverance, and justice. Traditionally a symbol of liberty, the American flag has carried the message of freedom and inspired Americans both at home and abroad. In 1814, Francis Scott Key was so moved at the seeing of the stars and stripes waving after the British shelling of Baltimore's Fort McHenry that he wrote the words to the Star-Spangled Banner. In July 1969, the American flag was flown in space when Neil Armstrong planted it on the surface of the moon. Today, our flag flies on constellations of Air Force satellites that circle our globe, on the fin flash of our aircraft, tanks, and ships in harm's way in every corner of the world. Indeed, it flies in the heart of every airman, soldier, marine, and sailor who serves our great nation. The sun never sets on our armed forces, nor the flag that we so proudly cherish. By displaying the flag and giving it its distinctive fold, we show respect to the flag and express our gratitude to those individuals who fought and continue to fight for freedom at home and abroad. Since the dawn of the 20th century, service members have proudly flown the flag in every major conflict on lands and seas and the skies around the world. It is their responsibility, our responsibility, to continue to protect and preserve the rights, privileges, and freedoms that we as Americans enjoy today. The United States flag represents who we are. It stands for the freedom we all share and the pride and patriotism we feel for our country. We cherish its legacy as a beacon of hope to one and all. Long may it wave.
Thank you to Chief Master Sergeant Reno and members of the Boy Scout Troop 177. The 7th and 8th grade chorus, under directed by Miss Kimberly Reno, will be performing our next musical selection.
As the quiet, misty morning awakens over the land after a long night of battle, a calm has settled across the battlefield. Here in this place, this hallowed place, there's a stillness, a silence. Soldiers now lay at peace. Some had families back home, and some had each other as their only family. Some leave behind a great story that will be passed on through generations, and some we may never know who they were. Their caskets will be draped in honor with the flag and sent home to their grieving loved ones, though their spirits have already begun the journey home. As we sing, let us remember those names of the loved ones of our Hampton Academy community shared with us today, who gave us the ultimate sacrifice, only returning home once more to their final resting place. We now present the song, Homeward Bound.
The quiet, misty morning, when the moon
Thank you, chorus. The haunting bugle call of taps consists of 24 notes sounded on a bugle or trumpet. This call can be played by a single trumpeter or in a call and response fashion. Taps is sounded at funerals, memorial services, and wreath-laying ceremonies as we honor those who have given their lives in service to our country. It is also the last call played at U.S. military bases in the evening. As our assembly comes to a close and we prepare to hear the trumpet call, we remember the words of our 33rd President, Harry S. Truman. Our debt to the heroic men and valiant women in the service of our country can never be repaid. They have earned our undying gratitude. America will never forget their sacrifices. Please rise for the performance of Taps by Andrew Bryan and Peter Furtado.
Thank you, Andrew and Peter, for your performance of Taps. And thank you, Masters of Ceremony, Ryan, Elizabeth, and Hannah, for presenting over today's assembly. Thank you to all of the teachers who helped bringing all of this together with our students, especially Ms. Duffy and Ms. Reno, who organized and directed the assembly. Thank you to all of the veterans who joined us today from American Legion Post 35 and Hampton Community, as well as Chief Master Sergeant Reno, United States Air Force retired, and American Legion Post 35 Commander Burke Bennett for participating in our observance of this important day. As we have the day off on Monday, please use this time to reflect and remember the men and women who paid the ultimate sacrifice for our freedoms. For those who would like to attend, don't forget that there's a Memorial Day parade, which starts at 11:30, followed by a ceremony at the High Street Ceremony. I think everyone did a wonderful job today, and I am extremely proud of the respect that our students showed for this ceremony and this remembrance.